Good morning, all of you. This is Dr. Deepak Vyas, teaching the subject Environmental Management. Course code is CH152, and I've already delivered two lectures to you. Today I will teach you regarding acid rain. What do we mean by acid rain? How acid rain is produced? What are the effects of acid rain on human life, plant life, and to the environment? How to control the formation of acid rain? Apart from that, we'll also discuss about the chemistry of ozone, how ozone is produced in the environment, what are the factors which are responsible for the depletion of ozone layer. Then we'll discuss about the importance of ozone, why ozone is necessary for human life, plant life, and to the environment, why nature has created this layer which protects us from harmful UV radiation reaching the earth's surface. Apart from this, we will also discuss about the PAN formation. PAN is peroxyacyl nitrate. How it is produced, what are the effect of PAN formation on human life, plant life, and to the environment, and how to control the PAN formation on this earth. We'll also discuss about a very important phenomenon which is occurring on the earth, which is known as greenhouse effect. In other terms, we can say that global warming. But before starting the new topic, I would like to brush up the old lecture or the last lecture which I have discussed with you. There were some common terms, means what do we mean by pollutants, what do we mean by contaminants, what is primary pollutants, what is secondary pollutants, what are greenhouse gases. Therefore, any substance which beyond a certain limit which affect plant life, animal life, and to the environment, it is known as pollutant. What is the basic difference, can anyone tell me, between the pollutant and the contaminant? Pollutant is the excessive discharge of foreign substance, and similarly, it can be present in the nature or it can be introduced by man-made activity. Basically, contaminant, it's not necessary that it exists in the nature, but it can be introduced by human activity. Like we say that phosgene gas does not exist in the nature, but it is introduced by human activity. Therefore, the basic difference between pollutant and contaminant is that contaminant is primarily introduced by man-made activity, whereas pollutants can be present naturally, but if the concentration of these pollutants increases beyond a certain limit and if it affects plant life, animal life, then it is known as pollution. So then what are the major factors responsible for any pollution? We have seen that there were four major factors responsible for any pollution: rapid industrialization, overpopulation, exploitation of the nature, and urbanization. These were the four major factors which were responsible for any pollution which exists on this earth. Then we have discussed about the definition of air pollution. Air pollutants are those substances such as gases, mist, and particulate matter which beyond a certain level or threshold limit which affect plant life, animal life, and the environment, it was termed as air pollution. In other words, we can say that when the natural level of naturally occurring gases increases beyond a certain limit which affect plant life, animal life, and to the environment, it is termed as air pollution. Then we have discussed about the sources of air pollution. There were variety of sources from which air pollutants are released. The first one was said to be combustion external, The second one was said to be combustion internal. Then we have pollution from industries. Then we have seen that pollution from ferrous industry, then from non-ferrous industry. Then we have seen that pollution from non-metallic mineral industry such as cement industry, glass industry. Then we have seen that pollution was also caused by petroleum refining industry. And then we have seen that food industry and burning old tires, burning of old tires and tubes, and incineration process were also resulted in the pollution. The main pollutants that were released into the environment was carbon monoxide, hydrocarbons, oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen. Then we have seen that what is the effect of these pollutants. We have already discussed that carbon monoxide is very dangerous gas. It is produced due to incomplete oxidation of carbon. Means that instead of forming carbon dioxide, it forms carbon monoxide, and it has much more affinity towards the oxygen, and it forms carboxyhemoglobin. Once carboxyhemoglobin is produced, then the oxygen carrying capacity of the hemoglobin is lost and the person dies due to suffocation. Then we have seen that oxides of sulfur. Oxides of sulfur mainly released from fuel, mainly coal, a thermal power plant, and various industries which are chemical producing, they release oxides of sulfur into the environment, and they mainly cause bronchitis, pneumonia and respiratory troubles. Similarly, we have seen that oxides of nitrogen, they were mainly released from thermal power plant, various industries manufacturing nitric acid, fertilizer industry and various other industries which are responsible for oxides of nitrogen. Then, apart from that, it also causes lungs disease, which is known as pleurisy, and oxides of nitrogen play an important role in the formation of photochemical smog, and which is known as LA smog or Los Angeles smog, which we will discuss today. And thereafter we have seen that hydrocarbons, they are inert in the atmosphere, but they play an important role in the smog formation. Then effect of particles play an important role in the control of climatic condition, formation of clouds, snow, mist, fumes. But excess of particles, they are very harmful, and there were two diseases which I already talked about. First one, it was known as pulmonary fibrosis. Then we have discussed about the black lungs disease. Therefore, these pollutants, they are released from variety of sources: combustion external, combustion internal, various industries, food and food manufacturing industry, burning of old tires, tubes, incineration process. Therefore, they need to be controlled. There are variety of physical methods, chemical methods and technological steps for the control of these pollutants on the earth in the atmosphere. What we can do is that we can change the fuel. We can extract the pollutant from the air by planting some devices. What we can do is that we can shift the industry away from the residential area, and there we can control these pollutants. Technically, we have seen that there were four methods for the control of the particle or particulate pollution. First one was said to be a settling chamber. Then we have seen that the settling chamber is based on the gravitational force, that the heavier particles will settle down due to force of gravity. And similarly, we have seen that electrostatic separator was one of the machine, was one of the equipment which was installed in the industry for the control of these particles, because the gravitational process or the gravitational force takes time for the settling of these particles. But if this gravitational force is replaced by electrostatic field, then the efficiency of the process increases and we can extract the particulate or the particulate pollutants very easily. Then it was, the next method was filtration oblique scrubbing, and filtration oblique scrubbing was used for very fine particles present in the gas stream. There were sheets, or there were sheets which were made of asbestos, glass wool, and the gas containing particles was passed through them, then what happened is that these fine particles get trapped within the layers of this asbestos straws of glass wool, and if it needed, and if it is needed, then we can have a spray of water on this, which is known as scrubbing, which will hold all these minute or the small particles within the within that sheet, and it will not allow these particles to pass along with the gas stream. Then the last method, technical method for the control of particulates was cyclone separator. Cyclone separator was one of the equipment and in which a mechanical string was tied, and when the string moves in a circular motion, then it creates a centrifugal force which will throw away the particles along the wall of the chamber, and these particles will slip down and then they will collect at the bottom of the apparatus in the form of dust. Therefore, these were some of the technical methods for the control of pollutants. We have also discussed some of the chemical methods. We have also discussed some of the chemical methods for the control of pollutants. For the control of SOX, means that oxides of sulfur, we have used lime, limestone or dolomite, which will convert the sulfur dioxide or oxides of sulfur into calcium sulfate or gypsum, which can be used in other industry. Similarly, we can also use lime powder, limestone for controlling the pollutants which are released from fertilizer industry, and it will form ammonium sulfide, and then scrubbing can be done for recovery of these chemicals. Similarly, oxides of nitrogen, there were several oxides of nitrogen which are liberated, NO, NO2, N2O3, N2O4 and N2O5, and therefore these oxides of nitrogen are made to react with sulfuric acid, which form nitrosyl hydrogen sulfate. And again, in several chemical reactions, we see that the nitric acid is manufactured and sulfuric acid is recovered, and that is how the oxides of nitrogen is converted into nitric acid, which can be used commercially. Then we have seen that what are the general methods for controlling air pollutants. What we can do is that we can shift the industry away from residential area. We can use catalytic converters in the motor vehicles. What we can use is the efficiency of the fuel can be increased. We can use unleaded petrol, and for anti-knocking, instead of using tetraethyl lead, we can use MMT, methyl cyclopentadienyl tricarbonyl manganese, which will not liberate lead into the atmosphere. Otherwise, you know that lead is very, very dangerous and it may cause lead poisoning, it may damage the central nervous system, it may damage the kidney. Therefore, this was the overall brush up of the last two lectures which I have discussed with you. Today, I'll start with this topic, which is known as acid rain. Let me move to the slide. What do we mean by acid rain? We have already seen that various oxides of sulfur, nitrogen and HCl gas are released from one source or the another source. Therefore, these oxides of nitrogen, sulfur and HCl gas, it react with the water vapors present in the atmosphere, undergo photochemical reaction and results in the formation of various types of acid. Therefore, in this topic, we'll cover first one is the formation of acid rain. Second part, we will cover about the effect of acid rain on human life, plant life and ancient monuments, MONUMENTS. So in the introduction of the acid rain, I would like to say that the carbon dioxide is naturally present in the atmosphere. This carbon dioxide is utilized by the green plants for the process of photosynthesis. But naturally, this carbon dioxide which is present in the atmosphere, it will react with the water vapor to form carbonic acid. This carbonic acid has the pH value of about 4.3. A small amount of acidity is always required for the dissolution of minerals in the soil, because these minerals, when they get the acidic environment, they mix in the water, and the roots of the plant, they can absorb this water and along with the minerals which is necessary for the growth of the plant. Therefore, naturally this reaction is always there. Means that carbon dioxide react with the water to form carbonic acid. But we have seen that there were two activities. First one was said to be man-made activity, other one was said to be a natural activity. In the natural activity, we have seen that volcano eruption was there, forest fires were there, and pollen grains were present in the flowers which flow along with the wind and they cause air pollution. But man-made activity is very, very dangerous, because we do heating process, we do cooking process, and the most important is the thermal power plant. In case of thermal power plant, we are burning a fuel for liberation of the heat. This heat is taken to the boiler, the water boils in the boiler and produces steam. This steam is taken to the turbine, then the generator generates electricity. And this process is not a one-day process. This is a continuous process that has been taking place for the production of electricity, because electricity is needed for household purpose, for industry, for running all the equipment. Therefore, we need to produce electricity through a coal-based power plant, which are known as thermal power plant. But basically, when we burn a fuel, the several chemical reactions we have seen that the carbon present in it will form carbon dioxide. Similarly, sulfur present, it will form sulfur dioxide. Similarly, nitrogen will react to form nitric oxide, and therefore the oxides of carbon, oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen, they will be released due to burning of a fuel in the industry, from the motor vehicle exhaust gas, from several other sources. But these oxides of carbon, sulfur, nitrogen along with the HCl vapors, they are very, very dangerous, because they react with the water vapors present in the atmosphere, undergo photochemical reaction and form variety of acid. Let us see that what are the various other acids which are produced apart from carbonic acid. I have given you the example that SO2 plus H2O, it will form H2SO3, means that sulfurous acid is produced. Similarly, SO2 plus H2O plus O2, it will form sulfuric acid. Similarly, there is one more reaction, sulfur trioxide. When it reacts with the water, it will form H2SO4. Therefore, oxides of sulfur, if it is sulfur dioxide, it will result in the formation of sulfurous acid. If it is sulfur trioxide, then it will form sulfuric acid. Similarly, oxides of nitrogen, when they are released from burning of fossil fuel, from various industrial source, from motor vehicle exhaust, then we have seen that oxides of nitrogen, NO2 plus H2O, it will result in the formation of sometime HNO2, and it will again then form HNO3. Mean that nitrous and nitric acid are produced from the oxides of nitrogen which are released from various sources. This nitric acid, sulfuric acid, increases in the atmosphere along with the HCl vapors which are released from industry. HCl vapor, when it will react with the water vapor, it will form HCl acid, hydrochloric acid. Therefore, along with the carbonic acid, various other acids are produced, like sulfuric acid, nitric acid, hydrochloric acid, which comes along with the rain water, and it is known as acid rain. Therefore, acid rain is a very general phenomenon, that these oxides of nitrogen, sulfur and carbon, when they react with the water vapors, it form corresponding acids, and when these acids comes along with the rain water, it is known as acid rain. Now let us discuss about the formation we have seen. We have seen the chemical reaction. Now let us discuss what is the effect of this acid rain on human life, plant life and on the environment. Now I will write down the effect of acid rain. After this, we will discuss about the Taj tragedy or Taj trapezium zone, that how this acid rain is causing damage to the Taj Mahal, which is one of the important ancient monuments of the world and which is attracting the tourists all around the world, and we are generating economy from this tourist. Effect of acid rain, let us discuss. Due to this acid rain, various acids comes along with the rainwater, therefore increase in the acidity of rainwater. Increase in the acidity of rain water, If the water is acidic in nature, then it will certainly affect plant life and animal life. Third, the aquatic ecosystem will be badly affected, due to acid rain. Next point is the rate of corrosion increases. It means that iron, which is very prone to oxidation, it will form ferrous oxide, then it will be converted into ferric oxide. But according to corrosion theory, if acidic environment is present around a metal, for example iron or any other ferrous metal, then the rate of corrosion increases. Therefore, increase in the acidity of rainwater, plant life and animal life is badly affected, the aquatic ecosystem will be badly affected, the rate of corrosion increases. And if we if the acid comes in contact with the human body, then blistering of the skin, and we have red marks on the skin. Eyes can be badly affected. If the acid goes in our eyes, eyes will be badly affected. Therefore, these are some of the dangerous consequences of acid rain. Then comes, I have already spoken about the Taj tragedy. What do we mean by Taj tragedy? This Taj Mahal was built by Shahjahan in the memory of her beloved wife Mumtaz, and it is one of the world renowned monuments which is attracting the tourists all around the world. But it is nowadays, scientists are saying that we can have a cover on the Taj Mahal, we can have a coating of some substance like polythene, polyvinyl chloride or any other metallic coating around the marble, which is a stone used for the building of the Taj Mahal. So what do we mean by Taj tragedy? Taj tragedy, a question can be asked on this. What do we mean by Taj tragedy or Taj trapezium zone? I have already spoken that Taj Mahal, it is made of limestone or marble. The formula is CaCO3. We also know that various acids comes along with the rain water. Therefore, during few showers, if it contains acid in it, most probably the sulfuric acid, then this Taj, which is Taj Mahal, which is built up of marble or limestone, then it will react with the sulfuric acid present along with the rainwater, and see what will it will be formed. It will form calcium sulfate, then it will form H2O plus carbon dioxide gas will be liberated. Therefore, this calcium sulfate, it is produced by this reaction of sulfuric acid, and the Taj Mahal, which is made up of white marble stone, now after years and years, due to various industry nearby the Taj, these oxides of sulfur nitrogen are liberated, and it will react with the water vapor to form corresponding acids, and more prominently is the sulfuric acid, and it will react with the limestone or the marble to form corresponding calcium sulfate. This is known as blistering of marble, B-L-I-S-T-E-R-I-N-G, blistering of marble. Once it is produced, then it will, the precipitate will be formed, and this precipitate will be deposited on the marble stone, and thereby the white, pure white color of the marble will be converted to yellow. And it has been a matter of research that how to protect the Taj Mahal from this acid rain. Therefore, the Supreme Court of India has passed an order that within the 500 meters vicinity, 500 meters area of Taj Mahal, no industry is allowed to operate. All the industry are moved away from Taj Mahal. And we have seen that the fuel which was used for running this industry was replaced by some other fuel which was less polluting, and the industrialists were given land and money in lieu of in shifting the industry from away from Taj Mahal. Therefore, a zone was marked which was due to high pollution creating industry, and it takes the shape of trapezium. You already know that what is trapezium zone, trapezium shape in mathematics. And when these industries were marked, and when it was viewed on Google map, it will take the shape of the trapezium, and therefore it is known as TTZ, Taj Trapezium Zone, Taj Trapezium Zone, TTZ, and this tragedy is known as Taj tragedy. Therefore, we have seen that we human being, for our personal benefits, we are running the motor vehicles, we are exploiting the nature, we are growing various industries, we are using fuel which are producing oxides of nitrogen, oxides of sulfur, along with HCl gas, and when it reacts with the water vapors, it forms corresponding acid. And when it forms acid, and when it comes in contact with the Taj, the marble stone, then we have seen the chemical reaction that CaSuO3 plus H2SO4, it will result in the formation of calcium sulfate. This calcium sulfate precipitate will be deposited on the surface of marble, and the white color of the marble will be converted into yellow color. There are patches, there are blisters on the marble, and therefore the number of tourists reaching Agra has decreased, and therefore it has ultimately affected the economy also. Therefore, along with the air pollution, we have seen that acid rain is produced, and acid rain is produced mainly due to oxides of sulfur, nitrogen, which are produced due to burning of any fossil fuel, because almost all the fuel found in this earth mainly consists of carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen and sulfur. The next topic which I am going to cover today, it is known as greenhouse effect. Why it is known as greenhouse effect? I'll explain you this. But the other topic which I am going to deliver today is known as greenhouse effect, or in other words, it is known as global warming. Global warming. It is a very burning issue. All the scientists around the world are worried about this phenomenon. Does anybody know what do you mean by global warming? Okay, I'll explain you that man has disturbed the carbon cycle due to deforestation of the land, that is by cutting the trees. Now you will say that, sir, what is the correlation between cutting the trees and this phenomenon which is known as greenhouse effect? We know that naturally the plant uses sunlight, water vapors, carbon dioxide for the process which is known as photosynthesis. Photosynthesis, the green plants, in the presence of chlorophyll, water vapors, carbon dioxide, gas and sunlight, they manufacture their own food which is known as photosynthesis process. But we human being, for our personal benefit, as I have said, that we are cutting the trees. Therefore, when the number of green trees are not there, therefore the CO2 which is released from various sources, whether it is an industrial source, from burning of a fossil fuel, from motor vehicle exhaust gas, or due to any incomplete oxidation, then the level of carbon dioxide will increase in the atmosphere. This CO2 gas is mainly responsible for trapping the solar energy.
trapping the solar energy. Now, can anyone tell me what is happening to the mean surface earth temperature? Can anyone?
Yes.
The mean surface temperature of the earth is increasing day by day, and it is expected that in the coming 20 to 30 years, the mean surface temperature of the earth will be so much that the human life, plant life, and there will be great damage on the environment. Therefore, we need to think in terms of this greenhouse effect and global warming. What are the various factors which are responsible for this greenhouse effect? As I told that, due to deforestation, the CO2 which is released from various sources is not utilized. Therefore, the concentration of CO2 is increasing on the earth, and this gas is primarily responsible for absorbing the infrared radiation coming from the sun. We'll see the entire mechanism that how global warming is taking place, but let me tell you about the definition of this global warming or greenhouse effect, which is known as GHG, and there is one more term which is known as GHG. GHG means that greenhouse effect, and GHG means greenhouse gases. Therefore, in case of greenhouse effect, we can see that trapping of solar energy by atmospheric CO2 and water vapors, thereby increasing the temperature of earth, which affect human life, plant life, and which increases the temperature of the earth, that is the mean earth surface temperature is increasing day by day. This phenomenon is known as greenhouse effect, and in other words, it is known as global warming. Now you will see that, sir, what will happen if the earth temperature will increase in the coming 20 to 30 years? Certainly there will be great damage on the earth, because the life sustainability will decrease. If there is mean earth surface temperature is increasing day by day, then it will certainly affect the human life, plant life, and to the environment. The survival will be impossible, and due to high temperature, the glaciers which are present, the glacier will melt, and certainly it is melting. And in one of the lecture, I will show you a video on this global warming, that the earth temperature, if it is increasing, then it will melt the snow on the glaciers which are present. Then the flood problem will arise. All the rivers will be flooded, and ultimately this flooded water will go to the ocean, and the ocean sea level will also increase, and those countries or those areas which are nearby the sea level, then they will sink. Therefore, it is expected that in the coming years, this global warming or the greenhouse effect will cause major damage. Now, let us see the mechanism with some of the figures I will draw on the blackboard, that how this process takes place. You know, this is the earth atmosphere. This is a sun which is there. In normal phenomenon, what is happening is that the earth atmosphere contains normal CO2 concentration, normal carbon dioxide concentration. Therefore, what is happening is that the solar radiation, it comes on the earth, it strikes the earth surface, and the short wavelength radiation, they strike the short wavelength radiation. It strikes the earth surface, it is absorbed, it is utilized by most of the objects, and they are again re-radiated back into the atmosphere. This is a general phenomenon in which the solar radiation, which basically consists of UV, visible, and short wavelength IR radiation. The UV, it is trapped by the ozone which is present in the stratosphere, because we know that the layer of ozone is there, which will trap the ultraviolet light coming on the earth, because ultraviolet light is not needed on the earth. Therefore, nature has a mechanism that this UV light is trapped by the ozone present in the stratosphere. Therefore, the earth receives only visible and short wavelength IR radiation. But once it strikes the earth surface, then they are again re-radiated back into the atmosphere with higher wavelength heat energy. High wavelength IR rays that is, it is in the form of heat. Therefore, this short wavelength IR rays, they can pass through the carbon dioxide present in the atmosphere. They can pass when they are coming from the sun, they can pass through it, but the outgoing IR radiation, which are of higher wavelength or it is in the form of heat, this carbon dioxide which is present in the atmosphere will trap this heat. And what actually is happening is that here the concentration of CO2 is increasing day by day. And in other figure, let us see that how the temperature of the earth is increasing. Let me draw this. This is again a earth atmosphere, but here instead of normal carbon dioxide, the concentration of carbon dioxide is increased due to man-made activity, due to industry, due to motor vehicle exhaust. Therefore, if the concentration of CO2 is increasing, the incoming solar radiation, they are trapped here and they cannot move back into the atmosphere. Therefore, this area of the earth or this area of the atmosphere where the solar radiation is trapped, and we have already seen that the solar radiation, it consists of UV, visible and IR. UV is trapped by the ozone present in the stratosphere. The earth receives visible radiation and the IR rays, but the IR rays are of short wavelength, therefore they can penetrate the carbon dioxide atmosphere. But once if it reaches the earth and they go back into the atmosphere, then what is happening is that this higher wavelength IR rays, that is, it is in the form of heat, and this is spread by the carbon dioxide present here, and therefore the mean earth surface temperature is increasing day by day. I will show you one of the bar diagram which indicates that how the concentration of this carbon dioxide has been increased from the past 30 to 40 years. Let us see this. This is the ppm level, which is known as parts per million, and this is a number of years. Let us take the statistics of last. This is 2015 and last 40 to 50 years. That is, let us take 1980s or 1990s. In the last 30 to 40 years, what we have seen is that previously the concentration of carbon dioxide was very less in terms of parts per million, but as the number of years passes, the man-made activity increases, therefore the level of this carbon dioxide increases, and you see it is continuously increasing. It is continuously increases in the year 2000, and in today we have seen that the concentration of CO2 is much higher than which was present in the 1990s or 95 or prior to that. You can very well see that in this bar diagram, today the concentration of CO2 is around 300 to 400 parts per million. You can very well see that previously it was 50 ppm, but now it has increased for five times or six times, and the concentration of CO2 is increasing, and this is primarily responsible for trapping the solar energy or the infrared radiation, which are of higher wavelength, and that is how the temperature of the earth is increasing day by day. I'll show you that temperature diagram also, how the mean surface earth temperature is increasing. Previously, let us take two axes. This is the temperature. This is increasing slightly, but today it is drastic increase in the temperature is there along with the number of years. Now you see that the temperature has increased drastically, and it is estimated that in the coming 20 to 30 years, the mean earth surface temperature, which would be much higher, which is present on today's earth. So this is between number of years and the temperature. This is temperature, and you see that the temperature has drastically increased. But along with carbon dioxide gas, there are research has been continuously done on this topic, which is known as greenhouse effect of global warming. We have seen that apart from carbon dioxide, there are several other gases which are responsible for trapping the IR radiation or the heat energy. What are those gases? Methane. Yes, of course, methane, which is marsh gas, it is also responsible for trapping the solar energy. Then along with this methane, we have nitrous oxide N2O. Then we have sulfur hexafluoride SF6. Then we have PFC. PFC is known as perfluorocarbons. These are also responsible for trapping the solar energy and thereby increasing the temperature of the earth. Methane gas, nitrous oxide, sulfur hexafluoride, then we have CFC, yes, of course, CFC, which is known as freons or chlorofluorocarbons. Freons or chlorofluorocarbons are also responsible for trapping the solar energy. Therefore, there were various conferences which were held around the world for control of these greenhouse gases, because if it is not controlled in time, then in the coming years the mean earth surface temperature would be much higher. Than the major effect, I have already told you that the sea level will increase, and those areas which are nearby the sea which will sink, because ice of the polar region is melting due to this high temperature, and the ice are melting. There is a flood in the rivers, and the flood waters, it is added to the sea, and the sea level is rising day by day. Therefore, there has been a conference internationally which the scientists and the various countries are thinking in terms of reducing the greenhouse gases. First one, it is known as Kyoto Protocol. Kyoto Protocol. Kyoto, it is in Japan. In the year 1997, about 200 countries they have assembled, they have spoken about, and they say that reduce the greenhouse gases mainly by 5 to 10%, which will ultimately save this earth. Therefore, Kyoto Protocol, and this conference was known as Kyoto Conference in Japan, where about 200 countries assembled, various scientists, researchers, they have assembled, and they have signed an agreement to reduce the greenhouse gases, which is responsible for global warming. Along with this Kyoto Protocol, there was one more conference which was held in Brazil. This is also they have also discussed about reducing the greenhouse gases by about 5 to 10%, which is responsible for global warming. Now let us see, along with the increase in the temperature of the earth, what are the major factors which are, what are the major effect of this greenhouse effect on human life, plant life, and to the environment. Therefore, first one is the floods in the rivers, floods in rivers. Or we can say that ice is melting, or glaciers are melting. GLACIERS, glaciers are melting. This is one of the phenomenon which is taking place. The other is climatic changes. Climatic changes. Climatic changes is taking place due to high temperature. Due to mean earth surface temperature is increasing. Third one, it is said to be. Then we have effect on plants and animals. Certainly when there is high temperature on this earth, it will ultimately affect the plant life and to the animal life. Then what we can see is that a drought condition will increase. D-R-O-U-G-H-T, drought conditions will increase. The reason is that when there is high temperature, the rate of evaporation will increase, and certainly it will result in the drying of the soil, and it will result in the drought condition. The next is that various crops like rice, wheat, soya bean, etc. Their growth will be affected due to high temperature. Then last, we can see that due to this high temperature, the various diseases will spread. Now you will think that how various diseases will spread. I will explain you that whenever there is a high temperature, the rate of reproduction of these mosquitoes and the development of larvae and fishes and various other organisms, they increase due to this high temperature. And whenever there is multiplication of these insects, then we have various diseases like flu, then we have various diseases like chikungunya, and we have various diseases like dengue fever, then we have malaria, and the epidemic will be there. Therefore, today I have covered about introduction of the air pollution, which I have discussed in the last two topics. Then I have discussed with you about the acid rain, oxides of sulfur, nitrogen, and various other oxides are reacting with the water vapors and results in the formation of acid. When this acid comes along with the rain water, it has resulted in the formation of acid rain. And thereafter, we have seen that global warming, it is one of the important phenomena which is taking. Last thing I would like to share is that why it is known as greenhouse effect. I'll show you some of these slides which will make clear that why it is known as greenhouse effect. But on the board, I will explain that there is a house which is made up of wood. There are windows which are made up of glass, and when these, there are some green plants inside, and when the solar radiation, they enter through the windows, and when they come inside this house, they cannot leave because CO2 gas which is there, which is responsible for trapping the solar radiation, that is the incoming solar radiation, which is of short wavelength IR rays. When they enter the house through this glass or the plastic window, the solar radiations get trapped within this house, and they cannot go back into the atmosphere, and thereby increasing the temperature of the house. Therefore, the same phenomenon is taking place on the earth also, that is the solar incoming solar radiation is reaching the earth, but they cannot go back into the atmosphere, and thereby the earth temperature is increasing. Therefore, the two phenomena which is can be correlated is in the house also, the incoming solar radiations are coming, but they cannot go back into the atmosphere. And one more live example I would like to share with you is that in a car which is left in an open sunlight, and if the windows of the car are closed, then what we see is that the interior of the car becomes, the inner side of the car becomes much warmer than the exterior, because global warming or the greenhouse phenomenon has taken place. The solar radiation travels through the glass or windows of the car, but they cannot go out, and the interior or the inner of the car becomes much warmer as compared to the outside temperature. And this is probably due to lack of convection. Convection is a process in which the inner air cannot mix with the exterior air, and the inner air becomes much warmer. The interior of the house and interior of the car becomes much warmer. And the same phenomenon, global warming or the greenhouse effect, is also observed on the planet Venus. You will be surprised to know that, but it is not probably, it is not due to the carbon dioxide gas, but it is basically due to this H2SO4 droplets, or H2SO4, which is produced on the planet Venus. Therefore, we have seen that greenhouse effect of the global warming is a topic of international interest, and various scientists and researchers, they are working day and night, and the countries due to Kyoto conference, Brazil conference, and Montreal conference, they are discussing how to reduce this greenhouse gas, and how to replace a fuel which is producing burning carbon dioxide. Therefore, more emphasis has been done on solar energy, hydropower energy, geothermal energy, which are not utilizing any fuel, fuel containing carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, which release various types of oxides into the atmosphere. Therefore, I thank you for this lecture. You have patiently heard me. If there are any questions, you can very well talk to me. You can raise any question related to this topic. Thank you very much.